Greetings, viewers. Welcome back to our show, This Black Life, where we deal with issues of injustice in the so-called criminal justice system. We have with us back in the studio today, Mr. Cunningham. And we are basically following up on a story that we first reported several weeks ago. And we're going to see if there's any developments on this case. And he's going to remind us briefly what this case is all about. But remember, viewers, if you have to share any similar incident that happened to you or somebody you know, please get in touch with us on this show. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
How are you today?
I'm barely
surviving.
Yes.
Okay. Now, since we already taped part one, perhaps you can bring the viewers very quickly up to date. Your case basically started November 2005. You were at home. You heard banging on the door very early in the morning. You were still in your basically underpants.
Yes.
You were dragged out by federal marshals who claimed they were looking for your brother. You were beaten up. They didn't have a warrant. You ended up eventually suing federal court?
Yes, suing the federal marshals for $20 million.
Okay, and at some point, the magistrate judge actually recommended that this go to trial before a trial jury, correct?
Correct. The magistrate judge assigned to the case found the federal police guilty of a police botch raid at my house under the Constitution of the Fourth Amendment.
However, what happened?
And after that,
what did the judge decide?
Well, before the judge decided, the government made an offer of $30,000 settlement to me, and I rejected the $30,000 settlement because I wanted to go to the jury trial selection.
Correct.
And before we got a chance to pick a jury, the assigned judge on the case overruled the magistrate judge and said, I'm going to give them immunity, qualified immunity. Judge Deborah Batts in the federal court, Southern District. She granted qualified immunity to the marshals, federal police officers, because they claimed they were directed to invade my house illegally under direction of a confidential informant from Charlotte, North Carolina.
And as a result of that, what happened to the case?
She dismissed the case and gave them immunity, and that led me to hire a private attorney to file an appeal on my behalf to the Federal Court of Appeals in New York.
Okay, and what happened?
The attorney took $8,000 down payment, and he's supposed to file a brief on my behalf. He paid the filing fee to have the case transferred up to the Federal Appeals Court, $500, which he charged to me.
Right.
And
then what was the next thing you heard after that?
The second day, he went back and filed his license, and 2 days later, the appeal was dismissed as no merit, frivolous.
Within status. 2 days?
Yes.
That must have been very quick action by the judges.
Well, appeals normally take 2 years. So he didn't find anything strange. So that led me to see.
What was your reaction at that time?
Well, I was caught off guard because I knew that he was only my attorney for 2 days and appeals, and that decided in federal appeals court in 2 days.
And he wanted the rest of his money.
Yes, he claimed he gave me an itemized bill, which I owe him $40,000, even though he was my attorney in the appeals court for only 2 days. I don't know why I owe this attorney $40,000, and he took $8,000 down payment from me.
And $40,000 to file that appeal? The appeal that was rejected?
Yes, in 2 days, frivolous. And how could the appeal be frivolous?
So that's, the breakdown is about, what, $20,000 per day?
Yes.
And then what happened to Mr. Cunningham?
He's a $300 an hour Madison Avenue attorney, private federal appeals attorney.
Okay.
But after that, 2 years went by.
And what have you been doing in these 2 years?
Well, within 2 years, that led me to a federal court in Washington, D.C. I filed a freedom information lawsuit because I wanted to track down the confidential informant in North Carolina who supposedly had directed New York federal police to break in my house illegal under the United States Constitution.
That's what the government was claiming.
That's the government theory.
So they wanted to get to the bottom of it.
Well, I want to get to the bottom of it because mm-hmm. the government never produced any evidence in New York federal court.
That in fact,
that a confidential informant from North Carolina exists.
Okay.
But they still won the case.
Okay.
Under immunity.
Okay. So you've been going back and forth to D.C.
Back and forth.
Hoping to
get
a FOIA case out there.
Freedom of Information lawsuit, FOIA. Mm-hmm. I can have the government produce documents about this, records about this confidential informant from Charlotte, North mm-hmm. Carolina. Mm-hmm. But in the meantime, I discovered that there was some fraud in the appeal in New York, my federal appeal.
Some fraud? How do you know that?
Well, the attorney claimed that he filed a brief on my behalf.
Who?
My private attorney,
Does
Daniel.
Does that private attorney have a name?
Yes, Daniel Eigenman, Mr. Daniel A. Mm-hmm. Eigenman. Mm-hmm. He's a New York federal appeals attorney on Madison Avenue, and he misled me. He had me thinking for 2 years after the appeal was dismissed that he filed a brief on my behalf. But the clerks in the Second Circuit Court of Appeals in Manhattan told me they didn't receive a brief from the government attorney nor from my private attorney, Mr. Eigenman.
Why are they telling you this now? Why not 2 years ago?
Well,
this new information coming to you?
What instigated?
Did they just call you out of the blue one day, or what happened?
No, what happened was, once the attorney sent me a balance of $40,000, mm-hmm. I went down to the clerk office and inquired, why do I owe an attorney $40,000 balance if my appeal lasted only 3 days?
Mm-hmm. So he was insisting on getting the rest of the payment?
Yes.
And that's why you said, you know what, let me dig further into this.
Yes. So the clerks at the Federal Circuit Court of Appeals mm-hmm. told me
When was this? Recently? A few weeks ago?
About 7 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
And the Second Circuit Court of Appeals clerks told me we didn't receive anything on this appeal, so this appeal was dismissed as you were your own attorney representing yourself.
Wait a minute. So they're telling you in essence that there was no brief filed on your behalf?
They told me, yes, it was no brief filed on my behalf, one, by my private attorney, and two, that the...
Wait a minute. Let me interrupt you one more time, because I wanted to be clear to our viewers.
Right.
So at no point did the judges who dismissed the appeal as frivolous, at no point did they ever get to look at a brief and look at your position on the case? Is that what you're telling us?
Yes, I am. That's correct. The attorney never filed a brief on my behalf, and the government attorney never participated in the appeal as well.
So there was no appeal process? There was no appeal at all, it seems.
It seems like that.
And okay, also, now when you say the attorney never filed a brief, what do you mean? What does the attorney say?
The attorney claimed that he did file a brief on my behalf.
Interesting.
But the clerks are saying the government attorney and my private attorney filed nothing.
The government attorney filed nothing because there was nothing for the government attorney to respond to, is that?
Exactly.
Okay.
Right. Since my private attorney ever filed a brief on my behalf, the government attorney had no position to file against.
Okay, now, if your attorney says he filed a brief, should he not be able to prove this to you?
Yes.
Okay, has he been able to prove to
no.
you?
No.
I don't understand. Did he not produce a copy of the brief that he said he filed?
He never provided a copy of the brief to me, and he
did you ask for it?
Yes.
And what did he say?
He said he can't find it.
Wait a minute. So the court cannot find the copy that he says he filed, and he cannot find a copy of what he claims he filed?
That is correct.
He did not keep a copy for himself?
That's what, so I don't know.
But I don't understand it.
That's the impression he's given me.
Was it handwritten?
Electronically filed, handwritten.
Okay, so if it was typed on some computer,
right,
would there not be a draft somewhere?
Well, the attorney told me, and he gave me a letter as a copy, that he filed a complaint to the appeals court asking for the archived file.
Ah, so he's maintaining his position that, in fact, he did file a brief.
Yes, but the clerks assured him.
And he put something in writing?
Yes.
Addressed to whom?
He put something in writing addressed to the chief judge of the Federal Court of Appeals in Manhattan, Southern District. Yes.
Saying what?
That his professional license is in danger.
Mm-hmm. Because?
He might be facing a malpractice, legal malpractice lawsuit from the client, which is me.
Because it is being alleged that he never filed a brief.
Yes.
When in fact he insists that he did file a brief.
And he gave me an itemized bill, a balance, unpaid balance of mm-hmm. $40,000 stating he filed a brief mm-hmm. on my behalf.
Mm-hmm.
So that's fraud, a lie.
So where does this put you? I mean, seems like you did your part. You hired an attorney. Paid a significant money.
And the court's filing fee of $500 approximately to mm-hmm. have your federal case transferred from the lower federal court up to the federal court's appeal.
Mm-hmm.
That's a filing fee of $490 you have mm-hmm. to pay.
Now, let me ask you, Mr. Cunningham. Normally, when you file documents in an ongoing case, isn't there an itemized, what's that called?
Itemized bill from the attorney.
No, not that.
In the docket sheet from the court,
right.
Yes. The docket sheet shows.
What does the docket sheet show?
The docket sheet shows that the government attorney and the private attorney for my behalf never filed anything. It just showed the lawyer filed his license on the January 12th.
Mm-hmm.
January 11th and January 12th, he paid the filing fee. And January 13th,
mm-hmm.
the court dismissed the appeal as frivolous. But one more mm-hmm. interesting note.
Yes.
The court dismissed the appeal like I was my own attorney under pro se self-representation status,
really?
Even though the attorney is on file representing me.
So how does the court account for that?
I don't know. So it's an investigation going on because I filed.
All right, so let me get this clear for our viewers.
Yes.
The docket sheet does not show that at any point a brief was filed, but it does show that your attorney filed what?
The filing fee.
And his name is there.
Yes, and his license to practice in the federal court.
And that does appear.
He's a licensed member of the bar.
So that does appear.
That does appear.
It's not the issue of the missing brief.
Yes.
So what if he says that, in fact, he did file the brief, but it was never entered on the docket sheet?
Well, that issue will come out when the archive file arrives next week.
Mm-hmm.
The court is going to retrieve the archive file. It's located in another location mm-hmm. in Manhattan in a factory or maybe New Jersey somewhere at the
right.
court. And what he's interested in seeing in the file is the hard disk drive, which will show and prove he filed the brief.
Mm-hmm.
If the file supports the court docket sheet that he never filed a brief on my behalf.
Yes. Where does that leave you?
That leaves him with I will file a legal malpractice lawsuit against his license, which is insured.
What is?
So in the meantime,
extraordinary turn of events on this case.
I filed a complaint against him at the New York State Supreme Court of Disciplinary Committee against corrupted licensed attorneys.
And when did you do this, and what normally happens in that situation?
Well, they investigate the attorney, and they ask the attorney to respond.
Mm-hmm.
And they just notified
him. They would call him and meet with him and say, what's going on?
I don't know the process because I'm a member of the public. But
right.
they do make him respond mm-hmm. to the client's allegations.
Mm.
And so far, they have asked me, would I care to have my $8,000 return? I said, at this point, it's too premature. I don't know whether I would seek a refund or file a malpractice legal suit.
Well, why can't you do both?
It's either one or the other.
Oh, you don't want $8,000 if...
yes,
okay,
2 years of under the impression that attorney representing me on appeal that he was never representing me mm-hmm. on. I think I would take my chances with a legal
malpractice. So which entity asked you whether you wanted the $8,000 back?
The New York State Supreme Court Appellate Division, First mm-hmm. Department, Disciplinary Committee.
Mm. So they are on top of this matter?
Yes, they just informed me that the committee is taking the investigation to another level against the attorney, mm-hmm. and they will be contacting the Federal Court of Appeals for the file.
How long may this take?
This should take no more than about 1 to 2 weeks, mm-hmm. maybe next week or the week after next.
Have they already contacted him and ask him what's going on?
I don't know at this point, mm-hmm. but I know they vigorously investigating, especially due to the fact that the appeals court dismissed, somebody in the appeals court besides the appellate judges dismissed my appeal as I was representing my own self, mm-hmm. and that really...
Well, let me ask you this. Did you ever file an appeal by yourself?
No, but this same attorney did for me in
the past. So it seems that they could not have missed something that did not exist. How can they dismiss an appeal which was never made?
Well, if the appeal was made, because he did file the notice of appeal.
No, but...
And the license.
Okay, so you're looking at both possibilities. Because I don't know, I think our viewers are going to be confused. If the judges never got a brief, see what I'm saying?
I see what you're saying, I see where it's going.
To consider your appeal,
right?
It means there, in essence, there was no appeal.
You're right, it means it was appellate fraud.
So on
committed.
What basis was your case, quote unquote, dismissed as frivolous? What was frivolous?
Well,
something has to be in front of me for me to conclude that this is frivolous.
Exactly.
How can you conclude something that does not exist to be frivolous?
Well, I see.
Why didn't they say it's a non-existent appeal because it did not exist?
I agree. That's what they should have done. They should have said, they should have sent some letters to the attorney saying, when are you going to file this brief so we can go forward with this appeal?
Or is it possible that they were just used to dismissing whatever filing that had been coming from your party, that they didn't even bother checking whether there was a filing in this instance? Oh, Mr. Cunningham, out the door. Oh, Mr. Cunningham, out the door.
Well,
and in this instance, there was actually nothing to send out the door,
right.
But they were almost on automatic action. You know,
in other words, you feel it may be premeditated.
In other words, there's a lot of explaining to
premeditated.
Do. There's a lot of explaining to do.
There's a lot.
From the court, it seems to me, and from the attorney as well.
From both. Because I'm a victim of appellate fraud.
This is amazing.
How did this happen when I paid money and
right.
I still owe money?
Right.
I still owe legal fees of $40,000 to this attorney.
Right. And you've already been enduring this case since?
Since 2005 to now. Still dealing with it. And I'm a homeowner. Federal police was found guilty.
Tell the viewers where this has put you in these.
This has put my life in, destroyed my marriage. My home is in foreclosure status. I'm a private homeowner. I haven't been able to go to work in 3 years. I've been traumatized behind the illegal home invasion in my house by federal police and by the outcome of the federal appeals court and the federal judge on the case in the lower federal court victimized me.
Tell us what kind of life you were living before that November morning in 2005.
I was a nurse. I was a homeowner. I was a law-abiding citizen minding my own business. And all I know is my house was invaded by a bunch
income,
of...
You had your income, your wife, you
yes,
had your
I
little
had savings,
daughter.
I have savings. I'm my savings are depleted. I'm on public assistance as a homeowner, and public assistance have a lien on my house because I have to reimburse all the money back to welfare.
And this is for out of no fault of you?
No fault of me. Being in my house, minding my own business, it was just a police mistake. And the government apologized on the record. They said it was a mistake. But if it's a mistake, why are they walking around with immunity? And why my appeal was dismissed under fraudulent purposes.
Extraordinary.
And at the same time, my appeal was dismissed as if I was my own attorney. Yet, my attorney license was filed into the court with a filing fee. So who in the courthouse dismissed my appeal as if I'm my own attorney without a licensed attorney representing me?
Well, I think the problem is bigger than that. It seems like there was no appeal at all. If nobody can, I have to see those briefs to believe that at some point there was an appeal. So it would be very interesting to find out what the archives reveal, to see if your lawyer is correct that in fact you did file the appeal. But even that, even if that is true, how could the appeal have been considered in 2 days? And they've already, in essence, told you that there was really no appeal because the government did not file a response. Isn't that true? The government would still have to.
Well, the investigators on Wall Street from the disciplinary committee against corrupted licensed attorneys, their theory is maybe the government attorney and the lawyer were acting in cahoots against my appeal.
Well, we have to go on facts.
But we don't know. But that's a theory coming from.
So I'll pretend I never heard that. Said,
yes. Okay.
As far as I'm concerned.
I can't go with that either.
We like to deal with solid facts.
Okay.
Everything you've told us so far has been factual.
Yes.
And accurate and strong.
Exactly.
And we want to encourage people that have similar situations to come forward with to us. With factual information and documentation.
Yes.
And it seems like you have enough of that you don't even have to rely
speculate.
On whatever, who else is speculating.
Exactly. Okay.
Yeah, we want to get to the bottom of
this. And I'm not relying upon it, but I'm the victim. And this is being
Absolutely.
Told from a sidebar
investigation. Tell them you don't want to hear what they have to speculate on.
No, they
tell
still,
them to get to the bottom
exactly.
of this.
Exactly, and that's what they're doing.
Right, but let me ask you another question now. What are you looking for? Are you looking for this case to be revived? Would you maintain the same lawyer to proceed with a real actual appeal if you're allowed to appeal? What are you looking for at this stage?
Well, the attorney, I don't know because I'm a victim and I'm inexperienced. I'm not a licensed member of the bar, but the attorney who is a licensed member of the bar is seeking to have the court reinstate the appeal status
right.
so he can be given an opportunity to finally file a brief on my behalf
right.
after 2 years.
Right. So at that point, you'll decide how to proceed.
Right.
Should that be the decision of the court.
Right. At this point, I don't know what to do until results come forth from the investigation.
Mm-hmm. Now, tell us briefly, don't get into the details about where things stand in Washington, where you had also been trying to pursue that Freedom of Information Act?
Yes. Well, the appeals court decision directed me is the reason why I proceed to Washington, D.C. and open up a Freedom of Information lawsuit.
Right. Because a new front line.
A new front line because the lower court, the lower federal court judges in Manhattan, they both disagree with each other on the issue of the federal
qualified
police.
Immunity.
Getting qualified immunity. The magistrate judge told the federal judge, federal police officers, you cannot have immunity for violating the Fourth Amendment.
Right, so go to trial.
And go to trial.
Right.
But the judge on the case told the magistrate judge, no, I'm going to go above you and give the federal
I'm
police officers.
I'm ignoring your advice. Isn't
yes.
Right.
And provide qualified immunity. So,
and this was Judge Deborah Batts.
But the
there's
reason
another
why,
interesting point,
yes.
and I'm sorry to interrupt you, that you should probably remind our viewers. This is the same judge who had initially dismissed your case when you first filed the case. Is that not correct?
Yes.
In 2006?
2006, she dismissed the lawsuit by practicing outdated federal law. And this same attorney, who's appellate attorney, who's Daniel Eigenman, who's my appeal lawyer now, was the appeal lawyer in the first appeal. And he got her reversed. But that appeal took 2 years.
Right.
This time it took 3 days.
3 days. Okay. It was reversed?
Yes. She was reversed, and they sent it directly back to
the same judge.
Same judge.
So you've not had much luck
with
this judge.
And that appeal cost me $8,000 with the same attorney, appellate lawyer, Daniel Eigenman. He charged me $8,000 in the first appeal to have her reversed.
So in total, you paid roughly how much on these cases?
I can't even do the math right now because it'll bring tears to my eyes in front of the viewers.
I don't blame you. Now, let me ask you this. Have you heard of any other similar instance where a serious case of this nature was dismissed as frivolous over a matter of a day or two?
No. Like I said, my experience with appeals, my first appeal with the same federal appeal lawyer is 2 years, the first appeal. This second appeal, same judge, same appeal lawyer, 3 days.
Yeah, I think the court ought to look into this a bit further, because even as we're speaking here, I'm reminded of a case. I don't remember the details, but I read about it on the Huffington Post.
Okay, what happened?
And a famous judge, he's retired now. He's, I think, helping pro bono the people that were convicted, and he says wrongfully,
okay,
and serving long sentences. I forget his name. He was involved in Hurricane Carter.
Okay, Hurricane
Remember?
Carter.
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Involved
story.
In getting him released.
Okay.
And he's been writing about this case, unrelated to yours totally, where there was something similar to, where a case, an appeal, was dismissed almost immediately without the judges even taking a look at it. And I think he actually did write that it may have been handled by the clerks.
So in other words, you're saying that the clerks have power to dismiss appeals.
I'm not saying that. I'm saying I read something that sounds very similar to yours.
Wow.
Yeah, but we're actually running out of time.
Okay.
This is interesting development. The last time we met with you, everything you had to say was extremely depressing.
Yes.
This is still depressing, but there's some signs of hope. At least it seems some parties are now paying attention to you.
Yes.
So we'll definitely do a follow-up and let our readers, viewers know what happens with this case.
Okay, thank you.
Viewers, once again, you've heard this extraordinary case. As we told you from the get-go, our show deals with issues of injustice in the so-called criminal justice and the court system. So if you have a similar case, you know somebody, it has to be well documented though. We want people with strong documentation able to support their case. Please get in touch with us and we'll also look into your show. Thanks again. Welcome to This Black Life, and we'll see you again in the next episode. Thank you, brother.
Thank you very much for having me.
You know, we hope you prevail. At least it seems like, they're paying attention now.
Yes.
And things could be working a little bit in your favor this time.
Thank you.
And I suppose you're to be commended, too, for being persistent.